Good morning. Welcome to the Lord's House here at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. It's fantastic that you can all be here with us this morning as we join together to worship our Lord and to receive his body and blood in the blessed sacrament of communion. Today we'll be using Divine Service Setting 1. If you are looking in your hymnal, that begins on page 151. But as always, you can find that along with all of our hymns and readings up on our screen this morning. And our hymn numbers are listed over on the board if you'd like to sing using the hymnal as well. And so as we begin our worship this morning, we turn to hymn number 523, O Word of God Incarnate. God's blessings to you all in your worship this morning. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. In the company of the upright, in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of us all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, whom to know is everlasting life, grant us to know your Son Jesus to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our Old Testament reading for this morning comes to us from the book of Proverbs, chapter 9. Proverbs here, kind of personifies wisdom as a person. And wisdom invites those who are not wise to learn from her. We, of course, at the end of this learn that wisdom is from God. And so if we are looking to be wise, we learn from the Word of God. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her beasts. She has mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her young women to call from the highest places in the town. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. To him who lacks sense, she says, "Come, eat of my bread and drink of the wine I have mixed. Leave your simple ways and live and walk in the way of insight. Whoever corrects a scoffer gets himself abuse, and he who reproves a wicked man incurs injury. Do not reprove a scoffer, or he will hate you. Reprove a wise man, and he will love you. Give instruction to a wise man, and he will be still wiser. Teach a righteous man, and he will increase in learning. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is insight." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In our epistle reading today is from St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 5. We've been reading Ephesians throughout these last several Sundays, and St. Paul continues talking to the Ephesian church, reminding them, very similar to our Old Testament reading, that as we continue to grow in God, we grow in wisdom, and we associate with things of light, not of darkness. "Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore do not associate with them. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, 'Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.' Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with all your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We rise as we sing the Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter. As with Ephesians, we have been reading through chapter 6 of John in our readings for Sunday mornings. And this continues from last Sunday as Jesus again says that he is the bread from heaven. He is the bread of life. Now, this becomes very difficult for those around him to understand or even to accept. And at the end of this, many of those who followed Jesus end up walking away. Jesus said, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Jesus said these things in the synagogue as he taught at Capernaum. Then many of the disciples heard it. They said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, said to them, "Do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is of no avail. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the beginning who those were who did not believe and who it was who would betray him. And he said, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father." After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. So Jesus said to the 12, "Do you want to go away as well?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Christ, you are Christ.
You may be seated, and I'd like to invite forward any children who'd like to come up for a children's message. Come on up and have a seat. Come on up, Ty. We got plenty of room, buddy. All right. Well, it is wonderful that you've all joined us today. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, it's okay. It was a little bit chilly this morning. Maybe we're a little slow. That's okay. That's okay. This morning, in our Old Testament reading for today, we talked about wisdom. Does anybody have any idea what wisdom might mean? Yes, Maggie?
Being wise.
Being wise. Hey, that's a good answer. That's a wise answer. What do you think, Zoe?
Daddy.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. So, you know, being wise, oftentimes it means that you're smart, right? You're intelligent. You know how to do things. And maybe sometimes your parents think that you're smart too. But, you know, the Bible tells us that wisdom is more than just knowing things. It's more than just knowing how to read or knowing what letters are which or what colors are which. Wisdom comes from God. And you know how we get more and more wisdom? By hearing from God. And how do we hear from God? Well, we listen to his word. When we have our Bibles, maybe when we go to Sunday school, when we come to church and we hear God's word, that's how we get our wisdom. Because without God, we don't know how the world works. We don't know who made the world without God. And so that's why all of our wisdom comes from God. Sure, we can learn some really cool things in our lives, but we always turn back to God and we always look to his word. So stay in his word and stay hearing it so that we can be wise in him. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us wisdom in your word. Help us to always find it from you, that we may trust you and know that you are our God now and forever. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, thank you all for coming up this morning. As our young people head back to their seats, we sing our sermon hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace be to each and every one of you through our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. When we use our liturgy, that is the words that we speak around the readings and the sermon, that liturgy is based in God's word. In fact, as you look in your hymnal and you look at the liturgy that we use, all of the responses typically have a little tiny caption next to it that tells us where in the Bible it comes from. Because as we worship, we want our worship to be biblical. And what better place to find biblical than in the Bible, of course. And I love it when our readings for a Sunday end up mirroring the liturgy that we use. Did you catch it this morning? Did you catch it in the gospel reading that the Alleluia verse that we sang immediately before the gospel, where we say, Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And then we read the gospel reading and we hear those words. We know this comes from God's holy word. But even more than that, when we hear these words in context, they even mean more to us, don't they, than the words that we use during our liturgy. You know, in the verses that preceded this, Jesus was talking with the Israelites. He was talking with people who had begun to follow him, and he's called them his disciples. Now, oftentimes we think of the disciples as those 12 apostles, but disciples are basically anybody who is in the discipline of someone else. So you could call students disciples. So Jesus had bunches of disciples, those who were learning from him. And he was saying so many beautiful and wonderful things to them, but they were difficult. They were difficult to understand. Jesus says to them, if I am the living bread that comes down from heaven, if anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Then the Jews disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Jesus said these things in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. I know, as we hear these words of Jesus, our minds usually automatically go towards communion. Because that is the same kind of language we use, isn't it? We eat the body of Christ, we drink Christ's blood. But there's been a lot of debate about this, and I even fall on the side of saying that Jesus isn't talking explicitly about communion here, because first of all, he hasn't instituted it yet. Because if he's telling them, eat my flesh and drink my blood, and then he doesn't provide it for them, well then what are they supposed to do? But that's a debate for another time. Because what we really want to see here is this amazing declaration that Jesus is making. And as we see the reaction of those around him, the declaration that he makes apparently is very divisive. He says that in him is life. Nowhere else. And as we look at the context of this also, these are the people who've been following Jesus because he provided bread for them at the feeding of the 5,000. He's trying to pull their minds and our minds away from this idea that if I just get enough of what I want right now, I will be at peace. If I just get enough bread, if I just get enough money, if I just get enough of whatever it is I think I desire, then I will feel safe, then I will be at peace. And Jesus is shattering that notion. He's saying it doesn't matter how much bread you eat. It doesn't matter how much wine you drink. It doesn't matter how much money you have or how much you have stored up. The only way you're going to have peace is by consuming me, by making me in your life, by putting me into your heart, into your mind, making what I say who you are. And when many of his disciples, remember this is the whole group of people, heard it, they said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, said to them, "Do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is of no avail. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life, but there are some of you who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the beginning who those were who did not believe and who it was who would betray him. And he said, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. They walk away. Instead of struggling with this thing that Jesus is saying, they don't want to hear it. And so they walk away. "What do you mean, Jesus, that I am not in control? What do you mean, Jesus, that I am powerless? What do you mean, Jesus, that I can only have peace through you?" This is not a palatable notion when we have in ourselves, as humankind, we like the idea that I am the source of my peace. I am the source of my hope. If I just work hard enough, if I just do enough, if I just earn enough, if I just grab enough of what it is that I think I need, I'm going to find peace. And so they walked away. And it is within this context that we get these words that we heard in our liturgy this morning. So Jesus said to the 12, "Do you want to go away as well?" Simon Peter answered, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God." Putting it within these contexts, understanding what's going on around these words actually gives more meaning to what we sang in the liturgy. We sing these words right before we hear the literal words of Christ. That's what we believe the gospel is. The gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John tell us what Jesus did and what Jesus said. And so we follow Peter here and say, where else can we find life? Nowhere. You have the words of eternal life. And then we hear the words of Christ. Because Jesus, sometimes, when he makes claims, they are difficult for us to hear, aren't they? He makes an exclusive claim. A claim that only through his work, only through his life, only through his death, through his cross, through his blood, through his body, can any of mankind have true life. Now, the fact that you're sitting here on a Sunday morning and worshiping with us today means that you probably hear that and say, yeah, that's what we believe. So it's not that difficult at all. But when we consider truly what Jesus is saying here, that he's not just saying that he's God, but he is. He's not just saying that there are no other gods, but there aren't. He is saying that you and me, despite how much goodness we think we have in our heart, despite how great we think we might be, despite our abilities, despite our brains or our hands or our strength, we're helpless. That's what he's saying. That we are utterly and completely powerless without him. Sure, we can bring ourselves some level of comfort by our strength, by our abilities, by the things that we can accrue. But we have also learned that those things are failing, aren't they? Those who are once strong become weak. Minds that were once sharp become dim. Things that seem peaceful could be shattered by anxieties and worries and problems. We work to fix so much in our lives, but no matter how much we work on, no matter how much effort we expend, we still got pain. There's still disease. There's still heartache and even death. The people that we have put our lives into, the people that we have cared for, are taken from us. And despite our best efforts, despite how much work we put into our lives, we must admit that our hope cannot be in ourselves, cannot be in our strengths, cannot be in our goodness. But our hope is in the life promised by Christ. The one who has eternal life in Christ is the one who hears these words of Christ and says, "You're right. I can't do this. I do not have the power to stand before God and say, I am good. But Christ has the power to make me his child. To not just make us good, but to make us perfect. Christ, by his cross, has covered us in his blood and has forgiven us." It's difficult and it's a hard saying to say, "I can't do it. I can't find the strength to pull myself up. I can't find peace in my own life." And it's difficult to hear someone say that to us as Jesus does. But then we also echo those words of Peter. When we are tempted to say, "You know what, I think I can do it." We also hear Christ's words and say, "Even if I don't like what you have to say, where else can I go? Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." And it's him alone who grants us that peace and that hope. So instead of us trying to gain our way into God's love, instead of us having pride in ourselves and saying, "I am good enough for God," we look at Christ and say, "Christ has made me perfect for God. Christ has made me saved for God. Christ has made me innocent in his blood. Christ has used his life and his death in order to save me from myself." And we can go into this world in the midst of the pain and the suffering, in the midst of the heartbreak and the sadness, and have hope and have peace. Because it doesn't come from our frail hands and mind, but it comes from the powerful Son of God who offers himself to us each and every day, who gives us his own blood and his own body, who from the cross brings us forgiveness, redemption, and life. Amen. May the peace of God that surpasses all human understanding guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. I invite you to please rise as we join together to speak the words of our faith in the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us join together in the prayer of the church. Father, we thank you that you have sent the Good Shepherd to have compassion on his flock. In his name we lift our prayers for the family of God, for every nation, tribe, people, and language, and for all those who hunger for the true bread of life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant us always, O God, to work for the food that endures to eternal life. Bless the ministry of this congregation and our community, that many may embrace Christ Jesus as the Christ and believe that he is the true bread of God who comes from heaven. Grant that we would never hunger or thirst for anything but Christ and his righteousness. Bless the efforts of missionaries who bring the bread of life to the ears of many, and we especially lift before you Paul Flo, Henry Whitty, James Sharp, and Carl Hansen. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Protect your people, O Lord, from the impurities of this world. Save us from the violence outside ourselves and from the hardness of heart within. By your righteous governance, preserve and guide the leaders of our nation as they execute justice in our land. By your Holy Spirit, change hardened hearts with the gospel, that true peace may be established. Bless and protect all those who serve the public good in firefighting, emergency response, professional medicine, law enforcement, and in the armed forces, especially Mike Shannon and Jesse Richardson. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bestow your power of healing upon the sick and the recovering. We especially lift before you Phyllis Winterfeld, Jody Gradert, Terry Vanderham, Vivian Johnson, Peanut Wagers, Merlin Rostermund, Troy Ranking, Jesse West, Shirley Kane, Dolan Grasshoff, Yvonne Van Wy, Todd Dagan, John Iles, Amari Brown, Ben Carlson, Hermina Van Roekel, Bill Martinson, and Betty Holtquist. Then in accordance with your will, they may give thanks to your name. Give your spirit of hope to the depressed, the lonely, and those who mourn the death of loved ones, especially the families of Ernie Harms and Helen Verhoeven. Strengthen their faith and assure them of your presence in all circumstances. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Within the fold of your tender care, O Father, we entrust these petitions to you, that you would hear us, teach us your word, and feed us with the bread of life, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you that if you haven't already, to place your offering in the plate at the back or in the narthex, or use our online giving options. We join together to sing the offertory. We continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, We laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Please be seated for our closing hymn. Good morning. Welcome once again to the Lord's house here at St. Paul's. It's great to have you with us. Thank you for joining us for worship. We do have fellowship time down in the basement today, so come down for some coffee and some treats and enjoy some time together with our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I will not be down there. I have to head over to Haywarden to do the service over there. And so I give you greetings and blessings and have a wonderful week in our Lord.